Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Michael Durack, and it's my pleasant duty to invite you to an evening of literature and chat and some music. There are four people on stage tonight, two distinguished authors, Donal Ryan and Julian Gough, who happen to be past pupils of mine in a former life. And the fourth person is my brother Austin, guitarist. And remarkably, he and I were also former pupils of the same school, which is Nenagh CBS in North Tipperary. So we've got a brotherhood of former Nenagh men on stage tonight. The format of the evening is fairly straightforward. I'll be chatting briefly with my two fellow authors. They will proceed to read from their published works. And at the end, I'll be joined by Austin on guitar for a few poems and excerpts from my own memoir called Safe to Memory, Lost View. And at the end of the readings and performance, there will be an opportunity for you, the audience, to join in a question and answer session, if you feel like asking anything. And in the foyer after the event, there will be book tables, which would enable you to buy work by the authors and have them signed if you so wish. So, to begin, our first distinguished guest tonight is a man of many parts and many talents. He's a poet, novelist, an economic satirist, a newspaper columnist, former lyricist and frontman of Toasted Heretic, a remarkable band, and the author of numerous comic novels, short stories, radio dramas, children's fiction, and in fact he also wrote the closing narrative text for the computer game Minecraft. He is the incoming writer in residence at the University of Limerick. Please welcome Julian Gough.
This has been choreographed like a North Korean birthday of Kim Il-young. We have a sheet of paper and everything's timed to the second, so you're in safe hands.
Julian, my last time interrogating you was probably in a Leaving Cert English class back in the mid-80s. I meant to say when I was introducing both Julian and Donal that because they are past pupils, there's bound to be some bad blood and some scores to settle.
No, you're one of the good guys. There are other fellas I would be just at this moment hitting them a puck.
Actually, my first memory, I'd like to share my earliest memory of Julian. I don't think I was teaching him in first or second year, but the school happened to qualify for the Harty Cup, which is the premier hurling competition, a big event, and the whole student body and staff decamped down to Emly in South Tip for the occasion. I think it was against one of the Cork colleges. And as the crowd was milling through the gates and chanting and cheering and flag waving was going on, I looked back to the last few stragglers coming through, and I saw up on the gate pier the bald Julian Gough seated, cross-legged, with his face deep in a book. And it told me three things about this fellow. One, that he was unlikely to be striped Troke Park in a Tipperary jersey anytime in the future. Number two, that he probably had a future in literature, some form or other. And number three, that he was very much a young man who was prepared to dance to the beat of his own drum. So
I actually remember that quite well. I was actually I was hit with a hurley by Vincent Coyne to get me on the bus because I didn't want to go. So having gone physically, I decided I wouldn't attend mentally. So I climbed up the gatepost, read my science fiction with my back to the pitch, and it was, I think it was the other lads from the school threw stones at me, trying to get me down, until teachers from the other school stopped them.
Those are the days of genuine motivation, isn't that right? Julian, your parents were Tipperary people, not from Nenagh, but you were actually born across the water in Essex and you arrived in Nenagh at around the age of 7. So coming to Nenagh in North Tipperary without a hurley, and with an accent which was a long way removed from the Nenagh accent, did you find it difficult to acclimatise to?
Yeah, it was even worse than that. I actually had a cricket bat. My granny had given me a cricket bat. Everything was done to help me fit in London, where we were growing up in London near Heathrow Airport. My dad worked at the airport as a fireman. And everything was done to help me blend in, because he didn't want to stand out in the mainland campaign. So I was called Julian, and I was an English accent, and I had a cricket bat and everything. And then they brought me back to Ireland, and I got that shite kicked out of me. So I paid the price for 800 years of oppression that I hadn't actually done.
And of course, Ireland was a different place, and Nenagh was a different place then.
It was very
much more homogenous.
Yeah, very different.
The influx of other cultures and other elements that hadn't happened. So you were obviously bookish as a young man at school.
Yeah.
Can you remember the authors and the books that appealed to you at that stage of your life?
I had no taste. I read anything that had words on it. I'd read the back of the Kellogg's box, you know. I just loved reading as a bit of an escape from, I think for a lot of kids, a lot of bookish kids, they like this other world they can go to very easily. I mean, a lot of it's down to RTE not being very good, because we came back to Ireland and we didn't have a television for a while. When we did have a television, we only had RTE, and we were the other side of Keeper Hill, and you couldn't even see what was on the screen. So I learned to read in Ireland. I hadn't bothered in England. I read anything. I loved science fiction. I loved literally, being on another planet. I found that very refreshing. I mean, we're all totally psychologically damaged writers. I mean, you know yourself.
And I knew, Julian, that obviously approaching Leaving Cert, you were never destined for a conventional career like accountancy or law or plastering or, God forbid, teaching. So had you a vision of yourself as an artist or as a writer or a musician even at that stage?
Yeah, no, that's very early on, almost as soon as I learned to read. In fact, as soon as I learned to read, I decided I wanted to write. Because I remember reading Black Beauty, Anna Sewell's book about horses and how cruelly they're treated. I had no idea of the history of that book, which is it was a piece of propaganda for animal rights to treat horses properly. So it's full of very sad scenes of mistreatment of horses. It's an old book. But when I read it, I knew nothing about it other than it made me cry my eyes out. I ran through the house to my mother and said, "Never let me read another book." I think I was 7 or 8 or whatever. But immediately after that, I thought, I can't, what happened in my head there? How can these little marks on a page have like completely turned me upside down? And I was fascinated by that. And I kind of almost immediately wanted to do that to other people or to understand the mystery of it. So very early on, I wanted to be a writer, but I didn't know how to do it for forever. I was useless for a long, long time.
Yeah. So you went to UCG. I presume you enjoyed the freedom of the student experience.
Yeah.
And you got involved in a band. I think I previously mentioned an amazing name for a band, Toasted Heretic. Oh, yeah. All kinds of possibilities, positive and negative.
Yeah.
Tell me a little bit about Toasted Heretic and your career as a rock man.
Well, the other thing that changed my life was David Bowie. I saw David Bowie do Life on Mars on Top of the Pops, and there's this video where he's this kind of alien walking along the beach with this black sky. And that was it. Again, I thought, oh, now there's another planet that someone is on and making these amazing songs about, Major Tom. And that song got under my skin in the same way that writing had gone under my skin. I thought, how do you do that? How do you make people feel these big emotions with just a few notes and a few words? And I want to live where he lives. I want to live where David Bowie lives. So I ended up in a band, and it was a very satisfying way to spend your 20s. I would recommend it to anyone. If it's too late for you, get your kids or your grandkids. Be in a band in your 20s. It's the best way to ruin your life. Waste your youth. It's perfect.
And what happened to Toasted Heretic? Did they die a natural death, or were you moving on already into literature at that stage?
I think the band moved on a little ahead of me. I took a long time to grow up. I think Irish men take a very long time to grow up. And really, we didn't make much money. We ended up playing New York and Strasbourg and Paris and Edinburgh and London and had a great time, but we never had any money. And that gets hard after a while, and some of the guys just wanted to be able to you know, look after a girlfriend or a wife or whatever. They kind of eventually, 4 albums into it, they kind of, you know, our rhythm guitarist became, he now lectures in linguistics at Trinity, which is not what you expect of a former rock guitarist. Angus McMahon became a photographer, and they did other things. So I was kind of stranded for a few years, yeah, between worlds.
And then you went and wrote a novel.
Well, I wrote a couple of novels even while I was in the band, but I didn't know what to do with them because I didn't know anybody, because it's very hard. This is one reason I'm glad to be writer in residence at the University of Limerick, and I like doing events and talking about things, because when I was growing up, and it would have been the same, obviously, in your time, there was no route to getting your words into the world. You didn't know how to do it. Nobody knew any publishers or agents. There was none of that infrastructure. So I wrote, the first novel I wrote that was published was called Juno and Juliet, and I wrote it 8 years before it was published. I didn't know what to do with it. I sent bits of it out to people and they got sent back unread. And so it's hard to get started. I think it's a lot easier now. The internet really helps. You know. Yeah.
And you went on to write, produce a collection of poetry, Free Sex Chocolate. Yeah. I love your titles.
They're actually the three words, apparently, they've done research. Free sex and chocolate, in that order, are the three words that sell the most extra copies of women's magazines if you put them on the cover. So I thought if I put all three of them on the cover of my poetry book, I'll have a bestseller. It didn't quite work out like that, but yeah, the thinking was good.
I suppose you found your real niche with satirical work, as well as comic work, comic short stories and comic novels. You wrote a short story, The Orphan and the Mob, which eventually developed into a novel called Jude Level 1, I think you later renamed Jude in Ireland. Yeah. And it has the most remarkable opening sentence. If I had urinated immediately after breakfast, the mob would never have burned down the orphanage. Would you expand a little bit on the scenario of The Orphan and the Mob?
I did put a lot of time into that opening line. I think an opening line needs to raise a question. Yeah. That story was kind of, that was a bit of a breakthrough story for me, because it was a way, because it's really about Nenagh CDS. Are there any lawyers in the audience? No lawyers, we're good. Okay, we'll keep going. There's an orphanage set in an imaginary town in Tipperary in the story. And it's really a kind of a highly enhanced, fictionalized comic version of Nenagh Christian Brothers, and it was a way of processing the fact that I had a very unhappy time there, and a way of kind of finding a way of talking about what had happened in a way that wasn't going to depress everybody else, and wasn't going to depress me, and that kind of got me out the other side of it. So I found that a wonderfully enjoyable experience writing that story, because I found a way to write about serious things without being so serious that you just sank the ship and everybody was depressed. And that story kind of broke through for me. It did very well. Yeah.
And you also wrote, I mentioned that you were labelled as an economic satirist, which is a most unusual label. Mm-hmm. And I was talking to you the other day, and it just struck me that maybe you had a career in, the option of a career in economics, because you seem to have a tremendous grasp of global economics, or else some amazing prophetic sense. Because you were writing about the boom and burst before the 2008 crash. Yeah. And you wrote a radio play called, I'm not sure about the pronunciation, The Great Hargeisa Goat Bubble.
Yeah, yeah.
Could you tell us about the goat and the goat's role in world economics, or in Somalian economics?
Well, this is actually, I read a little interview in the newspaper with the guy who did air traffic control for Somalia, which is a completely disintegrated country without a proper government. And he was actually based in a different country because it was too dangerous to be there. But he got a phone call one day, he said, from the manager of Hargeisa Airport, which is in the former Somalia, for Somaliland, it's his name. And the airport manager was saying, a fella, goat, just got killed by an airplane landing on the runway, and we're going to give him twice the price of a goat as compensation, because that's the custom in Somalia. And the fella in charge of air traffic control for the region said, you cannot give that man twice the price of his goat for his dead goat, because if you do that, tomorrow everybody with a goat will be driving their goat onto your runway to get twice the price of a goat. It would be the easiest way to make money in Somalia. So they didn't pay the guy. So I read that little interview, that little anecdote, and I thought, what if they did pay the guy twice the price of a goat? And what if it was the easiest way to make money in Somalia? And I kind of worked it up into basically an exact copy of first the dot-com bubble in 2001 and then the housing bubble in the global financial bubble in 2008. Because once there's a way of making free money, everybody piles in. And once everybody piles in, nobody wants it to end. And we've seen it in Ireland and we've seen it around the world. And I'm very interested in those situations where something that isn't true has to be believed in by everybody because they're all invested in its success. And I like those things. So I'm very interested in economics, but not really as economics, as expressions of the kind of lovely madness of humanity. But after I wrote that, it was turned into... it was the first short story ever printed in the Financial Times. And after that, then the BBC really liked it and they asked me to turn it into a radio play. And I turned it into a radio play. And that was heard by the head of Standard Chartered Bank, which is one of the big banks. And he told the BBC producer of that, if Julian ever wants a job as a trader, get him to talk to me. So I had the head of Standard Chartered Bank offer me a job afterwards. Yeah. So I probably could have had a career at that.
Yeah. But instead you went on to write a sequel to Jude in London. And more recently, it was conscious of time now, more recently you branched into children's literature. Mm. You were nominated for Children's Book of the Year for Rabbit and Bear. I gather you wrote that in collaboration with your daughter. It must have been an interesting experience.
Yeah, I wrote it by mistake really, because I was telling my daughter, I was reading my daughter a bedtime story, and it was a terrible one that a relative had given us this book without even reading it, and it looked nice, but the story was awful, so awful. And because I edit stuff, my own stuff all the time, I was starting to edit it in my head, and then I was telling my daughter, this is terrible, there's no tension in this, there's no excitement or drama. And then my daughter started joining in and said, yeah, if that animal that turned up was a wolf instead, then the wolf could chase the rabbit, and that would be kind of exciting, wouldn't it? I said, yeah, exactly, that's exactly it, yeah. And then we came up with a completely different story. So after she'd gone to sleep, I went out and said to myself, that's actually a very good story we came up with, you know. So I wrote it down, and then I read it to her as her bedtime story the next night, and she gave me more feedback, and we basically... She was my editor, and I was the writer, and we put it through this process, and by the end of it, it was really, really good, and it ended up being my first children's book, yeah, which is probably the best thing I've ever written. Way better than the Big Ego kind of, 600-page novels.
Yeah, I'll read from it in a few minutes. Just a final question, Julian. You've been living in Berlin for the last 10 years or so. Yeah. The great Irish writers have usually moved towards Paris, Zurich and maybe down in Spain and so on. Why Berlin?
I'll tell you a secret about the attraction of the cities that draw in the great Irish writers. They have very low rent. It's nothing to do with culture. When Paris was the biggest city on earth for artists, it was because the franc was incredibly weak. And if you could get a tenner a month from your granny in pounds sterling or dollars or whatever, you could live reasonably okay in Paris. And the same thing that went for Spain when Spain was popular, and the same thing went for Berlin 10 years ago when I ended up going to Berlin. It just had the cheapest rent of any major city in Europe, and it's all about but because the rent is low, all the artists turn up, and then it becomes a city of great culture, and everybody thinks it's fantastically cultural because it's full of broke artists just scraping by. And then they reverse it in their heads when they look back and say, yes, that was a wonderful cultural city, so all the artists went there. It's completely the other way around. Dirty secret.
It's been lovely talking to you, Julian. I'll now ask you to go and entertain the crowd with a reading from Rabbit and Bear.
Look away. I don't want to spoil the magic. But entertain might be a stretch, we'll see. This is from a book called The Pest in the Nest, which is my second children's book, so that came out last week. This is my daughter's favourite. And it's a bedtime story in some ways for 5 to 8-year-olds. So you're going to have to get in touch with your inner child for the next 10 minutes. Okay? Get in touch with your inner child. You're going to be read a bedtime story. I'll cut to the middle of the book because it's too long to do the whole thing. But basically...
Rabbit and Bear are living in a cave for the winter, because Rabbit wants a bit of company for the winter. And he's woken up in the spring by his friend Bear snoring. And he gets annoyed by the snoring, and then he goes out and he gets annoyed by this tortoise who's in his burrow, because he's trying to clean out his burrow. He just gets annoyed by everything. And then he gets annoyed by this woodpecker who's pecking a hole in the tree above him, and he's just annoyed by everything. And eventually Bear just climbs up the tree to ask the woodpecker to kind of, could he stop for a bit or finish up fast, because he's driving Rabbit crazy. So we'll cut to the second half of the book. So Bear is now up the tree and loves the view and is really enjoying it, and says, "You should come up here," she shouts down to Rabbit. "You'd love it. It would be very good for you." "You're crazy too," shouted Rabbit up the tree. "Rabbits don't climb trees. If you think I'm going to climb that tree, you're more nuts than a million acorns." "Are you happy down there?" shouted Bear. Rabbit wanted to shout yes, just to annoy Bear. But deep down, Rabbit was an honest rabbit. "No," he said, very quietly. Bear climbed all the way back down the tree. "Pardon?" said Bear. "No," said Rabbit, more loudly. "I'm not happy." "Then let me give you a lift," said Bear. "Hang on tight." Rabbit grabbed Bear's thick fur and hung on tight, while Bear climbed back up the tall, tall tree. "Are you scared?" said Bear, when they'd reached the top. "No," said Rabbit. Have we left the ground yet?" Bear looked over her shoulder. Rabbit's eyes were tightly shut. Bear chuckled. "Look," she said. And Rabbit opened his eyes. "Wow," he said. "That's what I always say," said Woodpecker. "Wow, wow, 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 wow." "Hey," said Rabbit. "Mountains. Wait, there are mountains behind the mountains." And his rabbit eyes were having trouble even focusing that far away. "There are mountains behind the mountains, behind the mountains." The tree swayed in the wind, and Rabbit swayed with it. Rabbit felt like he was part of the tree, and the tree was part of the forest, and the forest was part of the world. "It's nice, 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 isn't it?" said Woodpecker. "Wow," said Rabbit very quietly. "I thought the world was small and full of me, but it is big and not full of me at all." "Yes," said Bear. "Yes, yes, yes," said Woodpecker. "Maybe my problems are not so big after all," said Rabbit. "I think you're right," said Bear. They climbed back down. "I don't understand," said Rabbit. "I feel calm and happy." "Me too," said Bear, "but then I usually do." Rabbit looked up at the tree. "I can't believe I have learned wisdom from a bird with a brain the size of a walnut," he said. "A brain that it bangs off a tree all day." "I don't think you found the wisdom in woodpeckers," said Bear. "Ah, I found it in you, Bear," said Rabbit, and hugged Bear. "No," said Bear, "you found it in you." "This is great," said Rabbit. "Now I'll be calm and happy and wise forever." He lay down in the sunshine, totally relaxed, and put up his feet on Tortoise, who was still asleep. "Maybe not forever," said Bear, who knew Rabbit rather well. "Unless you practice." "Nonsense," said Rabbit. "I've changed forever." At the top of the tree, Woodpecker finished her break and fluffed up her feathers and started digging the hole for her nest again. Bang, 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 bang. Rabbit jumped twice his own height.
"Argh!"
"What?" asked Bear. "I'm angry, and I want to be calm, so I'm angry that I'm angry." And Rabbit kicked himself and fell over. "Why did you kick yourself?" "Because I'm annoyed with myself," said Rabbit, "because I can't change myself." "But you can change your thoughts," said Bear. "Change my thoughts? What's wrong with them? My thoughts are perfect," said Rabbit. "But your thoughts are making you unhappy," said Bear. "No," said Rabbit. "The world is making me unhappy. I must change the world." A little cloud passed in front of the sun. Rabbit threw a stone at it. "Stupid world, change." But the world didn't change. "Maybe you could just think about the world differently," said Bear. "Maybe you could accept it." "Accept, accept," said Rabbit. "What's accept mean?" "Saying, well, that's just the way it is," said Bear. "Not try to change it." "No," said Rabbit. Rabbit seemed so certain. Maybe Bear was wrong. Maybe Rabbit was just too different from Bear. And Bear was being silly. Bear looked down at her feet, a bit embarrassed. Then she noticed her feet were doing something odd. So were Rabbit's. Bear's feet and Rabbit's feet were tapping the ground in rhythm with woodpecker's pecking. Look, your feet have already accepted it, said Bear. Traitors, Rabbit shouted at his feet. But his feet kept tapping. I think your body and your mind are divided, said Bear, whose body and mind were not very often divided. Of course they are, said Rabbit. My mind is up here, being clever, and my body is down there, being stupid. I don't want my lovely mind to have anything to do with my stupid body. Now, I think that is where you might be going wrong, said Bear. Wrong, wrong, me, wrong, shouted Rabbit. What did you learn up the tree, said Bear. Oh, yes, said Rabbit. He remembered, swaying in the branches of the treetop, a very small rabbit in a very big world. Wow, he said, remembering. And he stopped fighting the world. And he stopped fighting himself. And in that moment, he accepted everything. Wow, 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 said Rabbit. Bang, 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 said Woodpecker. Thump, 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 said Rabbit's feet. Zzzz, said Tortoise. And together, they all made music, and it was beautiful. And Bear was so happy to see her friend look so happy that she began to sing. She made up the words as she went along. Spring, she sang, spring is a wonderful, wonderful thing. There was a tiny growl of thunder from the little cloud. Next time around, she sang, spring, spring is a wonderful, wonderful thing. Soon it would rain and the plants would begin to grow and spring would have sprung. But right now they were dancing and their minds and their bodies were one. And first mole and then mouse and then vole, and one by one all the animals of the forest came out to dance to the amazing music. The sun came out from behind the cloud and Bear sang, spring is a wonderful, wonderful thing. Bang, bang, wow, wow, thump, thump, zzz. Bear shared the food she had stored in her cave. She even fed Wolf so that Wolf wouldn't get hungry and eat the other dancers. And they danced and feasted all day long until it was dark and Woodpecker was finished pecking a hole in the hard wood of the tree. Wow, said Rabbit, yawning.
That was the best party ever.
Yes, said Bear, yawning.
I don't want it to be over, said Rabbit. I hate silence. I want Woodpecker to keep going all night, all tomorrow, all week, forever.
Well, said Bear sleepily, now that the hole is finished, the nest will soon be full of little woodpeckers, and they will grow up fast and need somewhere to live. More woodpecking, more parties.
You're right, said Rabbit sleepily. Good night, Bear.
Oh dear, said Tortoise. Is it that time already? It will take me ages to get home.
That's okay, said Rabbit. You can sleep in my burrow with me. And soon Bear was asleep in her cave, and Woodpecker was asleep in her nest, and Tortoise was asleep next to Rabbit in Rabbit's burrow.
Snore, said Bear loudly in her cave.
Down in his burrow, Rabbit heard Bear snoring and started to get angry out of habit. But the snoring wasn't really very loud. Maybe I should think about it in a different way, thought Rabbit. Yes, I shall stop thinking of it as a nasty noise. I shall think of it instead as a nice, friendly reminder that my friend Bear is nearby. And suddenly, the sound, without changing at all, made Rabbit feel all happy and warm. Yes, spring
is a wonderful thing, thought Rabbit. And tomorrow is going to be a beautiful day
with my old friend Bear and my new friend Woodpecker. Yes, tomorrow is... And Rabbit fell into his deepest, calmest sleep ever.
Thank you, Julian Gough. Our next reader, interviewee, needs no introduction. Best-selling author of three novels, The Spinning Heart, The Thing About December, and All We Shall Know, and a collection of short stories called Slanting of the Sun. He's also been nominated for numerous awards and has been the recipient of numerous awards, including Book of the Year, First Book of the Year, European Prize for Literature, long-listed for the Booker Prize. He's the outgoing writer-in-residence at University of Limerick. He's just given way to Julian. Please welcome Donal Ryan. Donal has a number of parallels, actually, in his life and career with Julian. One is that he arrived in Nenagh at around the age of 7 or 8. Just the thought has occurred to me that my parents made the error of not moving me into Nenagh at 7 or 8, giving me opportunities to become famous. Donal didn't arrive with an English accent, or I suspect as well he might have had a hurley in his bag. He arrived in from a place called Burgess. And for those of you townies and non-North Tipperary people, maybe Donal might explain what and where is Burgess.
Yeah, it's funny actually. I was, even though it wasn't as dramatic as Julian's story, and I came from 4 miles away, I was very alien. Nobody had a clue where Burgess was, or where Newtown was especially. And Burgess is kind of a GAA confection. It's a mixture of Ballywilliam and Newtown and Yahill. And it really is for the purposes of hurling, really. And I didn't play hurling, of course, so it made me more alien again. And the first words I heard from a contemporary in Nenagh were, "You're some Gaul." And I was fascinated, I had no idea what it meant. And so I never quite fit in, even though I loved Nenagh and I loved living there. And, you know, my oldest friends are from Nenagh. So it was strange, all right. And it kind of put me on the road, I think, towards being a writer.
And, of course, a double source of alienation was the fact that people of Burgess resented your presence at Aeroog.
That's right. I mean, I played football for Aeroog, which is strange enough to play football in a way, North Tipperary, for a start. And then to play football for a parish that wasn't yours as well. So I used to get, viciously assaulted playing against Burgess. So I didn't play very much. Yeah, so put me off. So 14 retired in glory.
And I gather your house was a house of books, books are a big part of your life from a very early stage. Can you remember any authors or books that registered with you or made a mark on you as a young child?
I think my parents must have bought a job lot of mid-century Americans somewhere, because they were all in my house. And I remember becoming convinced that J.D. Salinger was a friend of my dad's. And his dad drove a van for Petty Hogan from Nenagh, and dad sold sweets, which is the coolest job a boy's father could have. And I used to go with him. And I became convinced that somewhere on his route, Dad had met a fellow called J.D. Salinger. And he had written a book called The Catcher in the Rye, just for me. I was really a stupid child. I was convinced of this. And actually, I was in fifth class before Michael Gray, and my friend Michael Gray said, "Oh man, there's this book called The Catcher in the Rye, it's amazing." And I went, how do you know about that book? And then I thought Michael Gray had stolen the book from my house. And then I realised, oh God, I've been making a fool of myself. But only in my own head, so it was fine. But they had, like Julian, I had that obsession with this idea of me reading words on a page, these little marks on a page, and these became an image in my head that I couldn't shake off. My parents gave us free rein to read whatever we wanted. The only book I wasn't allowed to read was I, Claudius by Robert Graves, and I just read it actually last week. And I'm not sure why still. I know there is violence and horrible, in every line pretty much. But the man would snatch it back at me every time and say, "You're not reading that book." But I read, Norman Mailer at a young age, and I remember reading about Gary Gilmore's execution and the image of the blood in his trainers just seared into my mind, and I couldn't shake it off, and I was kind of upset by it, but also fascinated by the fact that this man, thousands of miles away, had written these words, and they were now an image in my head I couldn't get rid of.
So American novels made more of an impact than
I. Just because they were in the house, but I mean, we had everything in the house, Enid Blyton and Walter Mack and Roald Dahl, they were all there, and they all formed this big mishmash in my head, and I knew from an early age this is what I should do.
And still, when you were in secondary school, I presume you followed a more conventional path, towards a career, towards a steady job.
Yeah. I mean, I went to college 3 times, ended up being a civil servant, and now I'm a professional artist, I suppose you could say, even though it sounds far grander than what it really is. But I was kind of a cliche for years, where I was a civil servant who yearns to be an artist, and now I literally am an artist who yearns to be a civil servant. It's kind of a stunning inversion. I mean, you know, because I did love my job. But I mean, I had a great time. Actually, Michael was one of the first teachers I had, actually, and I had a real run of luck, actually, when it came to English teachers. I had 3 great English teachers, and I loved them, and I was in love with one of them, actually. So I was very lucky, because I remember when you came in and you read your poetry to us, and this was the most amazing thing, you know, because the CBS was a tough place, it was a tough station, you know, it was quite a violent place, and you were literally a gentle, genuine teacher, which was a great thing, it was a break in the clouds. So thanks for that.
That's strange, Donal, because I have very vague memories. I know that in some
Yeah, I know this. Yeah, I'm very upset with this, actually.
I can remember reading poems to some groups of students. I just can't remember. Yeah, I know, first years especially, although I had a habit of bringing in stuff for first years that was way off the course or wasn't on their textbooks, because a lot of the textbook stuff was fairly predictable, you know.
Did you hear a poem called John's Lane, or about John's Lane, about the old CBS?
I remember that poem well. But I can't remember whether I read it in school.
You read it well, yeah, definitely, yeah.
And I remember at one stage, actually, some fella coming on to me, I had made out a list of, or a collection of poems for the benefit of other English teachers when this new English course came in, and I was seen as the poetry guru. And a little fella came on to me at one stage, he said, I'm going to do one of your poems in the junior cert, because you could choose your poem.
Brilliant.
I think there's a poem called Stephen in the River or something. And I was pretty flattered, you know, but this fellow was going to suddenly put my name on the register of the brilliant text. But so you went to work as an employment lawyer with what is now the Workplace Relations Commission, is that correct?
Yeah, the Irish Times actually slightly misbranded me as a lawyer. I was never actually a practicing lawyer, but I did have a law degree. And I kind of tended to go with it, you know, because the Irish Times is a paper of record, so I don't want to contradict them, you know, but I was inspector, and I used to, I was in court a lot, right, yeah. So I suppose.
But it seems a bit of a contradiction, like the actual employment and even the job spec and so on, seems to contradict the notion of the artist, the creative artist. But it seems to me also that you managed this lovely balance between working life and the creative life and family life.
Yeah.
And a lot of artists, of course, fall flat because they can't.
Yeah, I was weirdly disciplined for about 3 years, and I managed to get 3 novels written between 9 and midnight every night. But even in the job I was in, I travelled a lot. I met loads of people, and I met people who were very much in this liminal place. You know, they were stuck here in Ireland. They had no real identity. These fascinating people who were completely ignored by society. And we're kind of pushed away, and we kind of denied they existed, you know, and it's fascinated me, and people's stories fascinated me. I spent far too much time listening to stories about people's lives and not taking down their actual complaints, you know, and prosecuting their employers, but just, you know, another day's work.
So how long were these works in gestation, the spinning heart and the thing about December especially?
I wrote the thing about December actually in about a year and a half, and I wrote it because I wanted desperately to impress Anne-Marie, my wife. I really wanted to make her proud of something I'd written and make her love something I'd written, you know. Because I was really jealous of John Harding, this guy called John Harding. And I think he must have heard this, actually, because he gave me a really good review for my last book in England, fair play to him. But he wrote a book called One Big Damn Puzzler that Anne-Marie loved, and I was really jealous. And I'm not very jealous, normally, but this made me really, I was seething, I was, this guy, you know. So I'm going to do it, I'm going to write a book, it's better than that. I didn't, but she did seem to have the same kind of reaction, which is very gratifying. Because I had no idea I would ever be published, you know, I thought it would never happen.
But you have no ambitions to write a Ulysses?
No, I'm going to forget about that, actually, because it put me off. Because, I mean, the English teacher with whom I was actually in love, I read Ulysses in fifth year to impress her, and she was duly impressed, now, in fairness to her, she was. But I thought, God, it's hard work, you know, and parts of it are just so unbelievable. I thought, I could never do that, you know, and one sentence in particular, actually, in Ulysses, I always remembered, it was on page 48 of the edition I had, and it was on his wise shoulders, through a checkerwork of leaves, the sun flung spangles, dancing kinds. And that sentence went into my brain and would not leave my brain. And it still hasn't. And I compare every sentence to that sentence. You know, and I have to try and, I have to meditate to make myself forget about it. Crazy.
I heard you quoted, or I've heard somewhere in an interview, that two great kind of moments in your writing career was, number one, finishing the thing about December, and discovering that the two novels had been accepted.
Must have been a massive... Oh, I'll never forget it. I mean, it's just so unreal. I still get goosebumps kind of thinking about it. You know, the day that I went to Lilliput Press and met Daniel Caffery and Sarah Davis Gough, who went on to found Trem Press. So she's now kind of a legend, Sarah. I made her a legend. I didn't. She made me a legend. No. We're nine of us legends, okay. I'm overblowing myself now from all of it. But anyway, just that day, and Anthony Farrell sitting on an armchair and saying, "Yes, Donal, we'll publish these two books next year." And I had to make him say it about five times. And then I sat in my car and cried. I don't cry very much. I cried. I was like, Hagen, you know, snotting, all that. It's horrendous. And rang in Marie, and she was crying. It was brilliant. Then I called to Nenagh on the way home, and Dad and Mem were crying, and we were all crying.
Something that occurred to me actually today, I was watching Leonard Cohen on a YouTube clip. Magnificent performance, I think, in one of his recent concerts. But it has occurred to me that there's an element of Leonard Cohen about Donal Ryan. You know, the perception, nice. The perception as this of this man writing about the misery of the crash and broken lives and so on. And yet, you know, the Donal Ryan I know is a very cheerful, upbeat guy. And I presume as well you wouldn't regard your novels as being as downbeat as the outside perception.
I don't know why. I don't know why the darkness in my novels seems so occluded to me. It really is, as I create them. And then afterwards I see it when it's pointed out. And people say to me sometimes accusingly, "Why is it all so miserable? Why is it all so dark and horrible and bleak?" And I feel affronted, you know, and I shouldn't, of course, because people are entitled to their reaction. It's always honest and heartfelt. Can't see it. No, I thought they're really upbeat, funny, joyful things, and sure they're not, they're miserable. I do strive towards happy-ish endings, you know.
And so finally, a few final questions. One, your work obviously has been translated into numerous languages.
Yes.
That must be a bit of a thrill as well, seeing Italian texts.
Yeah.
Has it reached to Cyrillic, Russian text?
It's in Hebrew, actually. It's in Hebrew and it's in Japanese. It's being translated into Chinese at the moment. And I have no idea how this is possible. And worryingly, my Japanese translator had one question about Maria, which is fair enough. No, which is Japanese. I said, "How is this her only query?" It was. And I just duly answered. And, I mean, some translators have pages, you know, for each page they'll have a page of queries. I just don't know how it's done, to be honest. And I didn't dream it would ever be translated.
It's a matter of faith, isn't it?
I mean, you need to be from the road I live on, in Tipperary, to understand it, really. Some of it. I know, I think, you know, normally the demotic and the vernacular is normally illuminated by context. Yes.
And the last question. Your spinning heart, actually, is on the Leaving Cert course this year. I was aware of it some time back. And I think for next year as well, 2017-18.
Oh, is it? That stuff?
Yeah.
Cha-ching.
So, no, just a
question. Not really.
Just a question, you know, I mean, I'm kind of thrilled, doubly thrilled as well, by the fact that I know the classrooms in there, and I know classrooms where I taught and where Donal sat and so on, there are youngsters now sitting down, you know, reading The Spinning Heart. And obviously we'll be faced with the torture of having to write about it in exams. How do you feel yourself about your work being examined or being put through the examination system?
I feel terror, actually, because I visit schools, I'm invited to schools, and I go reluctantly because I'm so terrified that children will quote me verbatim in exams and fail. I have no idea. I mean, I don't know what an examiner is looking for. But I remember you saying, Michael, quite clearly, any of you guys could be on the Leaving Cert someday. You could write a play, you could write a novel, you could write a poem. And Martin Fletcher said the same thing a few years later. You both said it was amazing. Yeah, but it is terrifying a little bit, all right, yeah. And actually, I don't know how The Spinning Heart is actually on the Leaving Cert, you know. And I don't know how it's on the second year, because I thought it would have been gotten so many complaints. Because of the Shawnee Shaper chapter. I mean, I was actually asked in the school, "Will you read the Shawnee chapter?" I said, "Read it out loud for the children." And I had to read it, and I was thinking, "Jesus, my mother read this. Like, this is horrendous. What was I doing?" From Shawnee.
Okay, Donal, it's great talking to you, and I want to give you some time to read your work. You're reading from.
I'm going to read a little bit from All We Shall Know, a very short, and then an extract from a novel I just handed in last Monday. It was 6 months overdue and nearly killed me. But and actually, if anyone ever meets my editor, because I know there's some people different from my class than you, well, and you might meet my editor, Brian Langan, do not mention me reading from this novel in public. Because he's a really shy, retiring guy, and he's very gentle, but he gets really cross if I read from unpublished books. I don't know why. Thanks, Michael. just a short extract from All We Shall Know. I'm a teacher in this, not based on any teacher I ever met, okay? So this is where Melody, who's the main character, is recalling her school days and her dearest friend, Breedy. Breedy Flynn, oh, actually, I have to say before I start, this got me in awful trouble. World Book Day is a thing. It's been part of my life for the last 5 years, and I'd never heard of it before this, and it's a great thing. But there are about 5 World Book Days, and the main one, it seems, is around September 20th every year, which is our wedding anniversary. And so I'm always in trouble because I have to do something that night that isn't celebrating our anniversary, which I should be doing. And I always seem to have just published a book as well around the same time. And so I'm always exhausted and a bit grumpy and a bit kind of half mad. And so last September, on World Book Day, I was told we were launching the book, and I was doing interviews with the Irish Independent, and I made a fool of myself in one of those, and I was very upset. And I was brought across to Dublin Castle by my publisher's PR manager. And we walked into Dublin Castle, and I saw a huge stage and a band playing at this massive stage, like a rock festival. I was thinking, oh, that's great. Now, when I finish my reading, which is obviously somewhere down in the bowels of Dublin Castle to a very small group, we can come back out here and enjoy the band and the concert and everything. And 15 minutes later, I was on that stage, standing there like an idiot going, oh Christ. And then I couldn't find the reading I'd marked in my book. And so I opened it on page 31 and read this extract I'm going to read now. And my mum rang and she goes, what are we doing talking about erections on the radio? But what do you mean on the radio? I didn't realise it was live on radio. And actually, I was so embarrassed, after I finished reading, I was struck deaf. And Sean Rocks, I could see his lips moving, and he was asking me questions, and I had no idea what he was saying. And I just stood there looking back at him. And I could see Sean Rocks' eyes panic, and he was going, why is he doing this to me? And this is before I knew it was actually live radio. And Enright said to me, Donal, it's not even 9 o'clock, and you're on the radio talking about erections. What are you doing? Oh, God, the whole thing was terrible. Anyway, Brady Flynn in geography, across the room from me because we'd been separated for talking, scowling at the cool girls in their huddled, smirking group, curling her lip at the lads at the back, flicking a spitball from her desk back towards them. They're talking too, sir, she suddenly says, and Horny Cards Hennigan turns round from the blackboard, from his chalk diagram of the layers of the earth, and Breedy is pointing at the cool girls. Worry about yourself, Miss Flynn, and the F you're going to get from me at Christmas. You're going to give me an F for Christmas. An F. And she draws the F along her breath and purses her lips to the shape of a kiss. And the lads laugh, and the cool girls roll their eyes. Horny Cards takes his position facing us, sitting back against the edge of his desk. He seems priapic, as he always did, because of the way his perpetual corduroy trousers bunch at the fly. He folds his arms and opens his mouth to speak, but Breedy gets there first. I like your big erection, sir. And Mr. Hannigan's eyes widen and swing towards her, and his arms uncross and his hands swing down to form a shield across his crotch, of their own accord, it seems. And he straightens himself, and he opens his mouth, but no sound comes out. And Breedy says, at the side of your house, is it a kitchen extension or an extra bedroom? And Horny Cards flops in purple into his chair, and even the cool girls are laughing, and Breedy Flynn winks across at me, and I wake up laughing and crying, and I'm still here, and she's long gone. Got big trouble over there. So this is an extract from my new novel, which is called Provisionally From a Low and Quiet Sea, but my dear friend Alan Hayes from Ireland House just reminded me today that Dermot Bulger just published a book with a very similar title. But I mean, you know, I thought this years ago, like, so hard luck now. So this part of the book concerns a man called Farouk Alahad, who is trying to transport his wife and daughter across the Mediterranean from Syria, and is based on an actual person I read about, who's now on the island of Lesbos without his wife and daughter because they were drowned. He's a brain surgeon on Lesbos still. So at this point, they're actually on the boat. So I think it's about 4 minutes, in case you're going, oh, is it ever going to end? The sobbing noise was in his ears a while before he realised it was coming from his daughter. His wife had been speaking to her in a low voice, a story about a girl who'd been taken prisoner by a king who wanted to marry her. But he was old and very ugly, and she would never love him. So he kept her locked away in a room in a tower filled with pretty things, all sorts of jewellery and clothes and musical instruments. And performers and clowns and storytellers were sent every day to amuse her. But she spent her days sitting by a window, feeding a tiny bird who landed on the sill, and whispering to the bird. And the king would visit in the evening, but the girl would never speak to him. and he asked his best archer to kill the bird one day. And he watched from afar, through a looking glass, as a tiny arrow pierced the bird's heart, right there on the windowsill, as the girl was whispering to it. And he watched as she sat there, crying silently for hours, and her tears formed a tiny lake around the bird's little body. And eventually, the king regretted what he had done, and he tried to command all the birds of the sky to visit the girl, and to sit on her sill while she whispered to them. But the birds wouldn't listen. They wouldn't even stay still while he shouted at the sky and the trees, and the king's rage flooded through him and drove him insane, and he asked his archers to kill every bird in the kingdom, and they obeyed him because they were afraid of him. And the killing of the birds took years and years and cost the king all his gold and all his castles, because he had to recruit archers from all over the world to kill the birds. But eventually, the skies of the kingdom were empty of birds, and birdsong was never heard again, and the king was a feeble old man living in a tiny shack in a silent forest, and the girl had long since escaped the tower and returned to her home and her family, and the king had long forgotten why he hated birds so much, why he had killed them all. And Farouk wondered why Martha had chosen a story so sad, why she had made her daughter cry, and he realised that every other passenger had fallen silent, and they were all looking now at his wife, and the only light there in the hold was from the slit along the jamb of the hatch above them, and from the torches of iPhones. But he could see that some of the women and the girls had tears in their eyes, and some of the men had thoughtful expressions, and some looked angry. And the only sound was his daughter's low sobs as she clung fast to her mother, and the sound of his wife saying, "Hush, love, it's not a true story, it's a fable, and its moral is how useless it is to blame others for things not being as we'd like them to be." And then the complaining man stood, and Farouk expected him to rebuke Martha for telling such a story. And Farouk prepared himself to defend his wife, to cut the complaining man down to size, to tell him to be quiet and keep his whining to himself, that he should be ashamed of himself for taking so to heart a story told by a woman to her child. But the complaining man just said, "The life jackets. We gave them to that boy because he said that they'd be replaced. Come on, my friends. We have to see the captain and the crew. We can't just sit here in the dark like fools." And another voice behind him said, "There are no life jackets on this boat. There is nothing on this boat but us." Farouk enjoyed the telling of the story. Each time he told it, something new occurred to him, some different meaning that could be ascribed to the girl and the tower and the king and his war against the birds. Interviewers would invariably try to stop him at that part, tell him it wasn't relevant, that he didn't need to add this detail to his application, that there wasn't space for it, and he would pause and he would regard him solemnly, and he would wait until they began to shift uncomfortably in their seat, or to exhort him to continue, and he would say, "This is the most important part of my story. This is my story." And he'd laugh then, or sometimes cry, or sometimes both a little at the same time. Laughing and crying seemed equally ridiculous, equally useless. They seemed to be the same thing, ebb and flood of the same water, creeping inversions of each other, night, day, night, day, night. Sometimes he imagined the interviewer to be God, and the purpose of the interview to be to secure his passage to heaven, to ascertain his eligibility for a place in the afterlife, to decide the quality of his treatment there. Sometimes he imagined the interviewer to be a child, and so he told his story from its beginning in the simplest of terms, in short sentences enunciated slowly, and sometimes he skipped straight to the story of the king and the girl and the birds, and the interviewers would shake their heads and tell him that the session was terminated, that he shouldn't have made an application if he was unwilling to cooperate, to help himself, if he wasn't prepared to give a full and frank account of the reasons he was claiming asylum in their land. He sometimes wondered if he lied. They supposed him to be lying, all of them, about being a doctor, about being smuggled in a fishing boat, about the reasons he had left his home, about his wife, about his daughter. Perhaps he had never had a daughter or a wife. They no longer seemed possible. The sea, when he looked at it, always seemed quiet. The storm that had thrown their boat from truck to crest to truck and splintered it to pieces didn't seem like a thing that could really have happened. The complaining man at the door to the bridge, shouting, open up in there, imploring him to help him at the handle of the door, to help him break it down. The screaming wind, the screaming, the door giving way, their bodies falling over each other into the emptiness of the bridge, the silent, soulless place, the flashing, beeping box set by the wheel, locked to it, the autopilot and the sat-nav, and the disgusted sea lashing all its rage against the prow, and then against the stern, and then against the port side, and then against the starboard side, and then against the mast and boom and deck and hold, and all the souls aboard the cruelest craft, the small boat dumbly sailing to its doom.
Finally, I'd like to introduce my brother Austin, a guitarist, a man who's been playing guitar for a long, long time, has produced numerous albums and has been appeared on RT, radio and television. And he's going to add some musical touches to a few of the poems from my memoir, which is called Saved Memory, Austin Durack. The first poem we're going to do is about a motorway, or a stretch of motorway, near Junction 27 on the M7. And it's not just any old stretch of motorway, it's because it happens to run right through the farm on which Austin and I grew up, literally underneath the fields where we played and worked as children. So the poem is called Junction 27, and the whole motorway operation was probably the reason why I started to write this memoir. And just by way of a short introduction, I'll just read the first few short paragraphs from the first chapter of the book, the chapter called A Farewell to Tutankhamun. The landscape of my childhood is no more. The house where I was born lies derelict, hovering above the northbound lanes of the M7 motorway. The motorway cuts a swathe through the fields of my youth, and the extensive quarrying operations that accompanied the construction have devastated the hill of Tutankhamun, reducing the core 30-acre section of our family farm to a desolate wasteland. Which is why I feel the need to revisit that landscape, to acknowledge and to bid farewell to those victims of the inexorable tide of progress, the dwelling house, the barns, and the fields of my impressionable early years. The yellow earth movers of the National Roads Authority subsided in the Hades of Anaholte's bottomless bog. The apparatus of the M7 motorway wreaked a merciless revenge on Garden Hill, Tutankhamun, Cooleen and Ballyard. Now, as I surf the peaty brown, motoring eastwards to exit 27, my birth home, a home no longer, hangs on the edge of a limestone terrace, and quarried cliffs stand sentinel to a virgin Lake Avernus. I slide beneath the putative pond field, beneath the rushy well field, beneath the field across the road, before surfacing at sixes and sevens, not Charon touting for a dismal fare, nor Orpheus fingering his broken lyre, a weary Usheen in a seatbelt maybe, on a slip road in Coolderry. The railway bridge about 3 or 4 miles from where we lived. And Austin's accompanying piece is a kind of talking railroad blues, called Train of Thought, and the two complement each other. Just again to introduce the whole theme of the two pieces, I'd like to read a short excerpt from a chapter called Making Tracks in my memoir. My brothers and I grew up on a farm just over a mile from a railway line, and the hooting of the 10 to 1 and the 10 to 4 as they chug into Birdtail station heralds our lunch and tea breaks from the agricultural grind of meadow, tillage field and peat bog. Less than 2 miles east of the station is a railway bridge, which represents a significant landmark in the topography of my childhood. It is called Kilmistulla Bridge, after the local river of that name, and takes the form of a narrow hairpin with black and amber markings on the old N7 National Primary Road. It is a treacherous double bend, and it has claimed the life of a truck driver in the early 1950s. In time, a new tunnel will be created, the road straightened in the process, and the old bridge, with its little cross to remember the unfortunate truck driver, bypassed and neglected. With the arrival of the M7 motorway, it will be doubly bypassed. But for a time in my life, this bridge marks the boundary of the local and the exotic. From my home village to Kilmistulla Bridge, the railway and the road course by the familiar fields and houses of Cool and Lacken. But beyond those deadly bends is the great big world that throws up remote settlements like Mount Rath, Port Arlington, Newbridge, and the great metropolis of Dublin. So the railway defines a kind of watershed for me, and the train is not so much a mode of conveyance as a source of rhythm and music, a fanfare, a timepiece. Beyond the black and amber coil, where death played hide and seek and found, lay far exotic places. Mount Rath, Dublin, Moscow, Kathmandu, behind the station at Birdtail and home. This was my Rubicon, my Cape Bucador. The 20-9 and 10-4, throbbed by familiar fields in Cool and Lacken, before bolting into the great out yonder through the eye of Kilmistulla Bridge. In time, I grew, horizons widened. The bridge diminished to a thin zigzag, bypassed by engineers whose concrete tunnel shoulders with ease the grinding juggernauts. I, too, bypassed for years until curiosity led me by the hand to that out-of-the-way meander, now hatching potholes, weeds, and refuse. Below, the rails zoomed west towards Birdtail. Behind me, Dublin, Rome, Afghanistan.
There was no clock to tell the time. In those days, no watch was mine. We'd be listening and waiting for you. That rocking sound and the horn you blew. You started slowly, picked up speed. Satisfied a simple need. We'd be listening and waiting for you. In the garden and in the meadow too. In Tutankhamun hardly. Well field, Corrigan, we'd be listening and waiting for you. sound horn you blew. The 10 to 1, the 10 to 4, those were the trains we waited for. We'd be listening and waiting for you. In the garden and in the meadow too.
Sods, and accompanied by a cheerful, familiar melody from the early 1960s. And just a quick introduction again, it's about the pen-ups of my childhood and adolescence. When I was old enough to sense the allure of the female form, I was attracted to American teen stars like Sandra Dee, Connie Stevens, and Tuesday Weld. I was aware of the Rita Hayworths and Elizabeth Taylors of Planet Hollywood, but they were mature actresses, too grown up for me. And the world had long said goodbye to Norma Jean Baker before I engaged with the mythology of Marilyn Monroe, her marriages to Joe DiMaggio and Arthur Miller, her association with the Kennedys, and the mystery of her final hours. In the mid-60s, I metamorphosed into an awkward teenager, chronically shy and no oil painting to boot. But I discovered local goddesses with ordinary names and unexceptional day-to-day lives. They would become pressing objects of my fantasies and my libido, although the world of celebrity still threw up exotic female forms to pin up adjacent to the Madonnas and Sacred Hearts of my Catholic bedroom walls. These new splashes of female pulchritude included the model Jean Shrimpton and the incomparably beautiful English actress Julie Christie. I was knee-high to Brenda Lee. I fell hopelessly in love with Farah Diba. It was love against all the odds. She being much older and a non-Catholic, not to mention her engagement to the Shah of Persia. Nothing ever came of it, of course. Subsequently, I lost my heart to others. Connie Stevens, Sandra Dee, oh yes, and Jean Shrimpton, Julie Christie, Tuesday Weld. Invariably, my love was unrequited. Then, sensing that I was just a plain, ordinary sod, I resolved to settle for local goddesses with names like Maureen, Sheila, Mary, Anne, from places like Bartil and Drumanier, and it was fun. I inclined to shed my dreams of London, Beverly Hills and Tehran, took up the guitar, grew a beard and became captain of the local rugby club. Sods make their own importance. The performance